How many new people do we have tonight? Well, what you need to know is you're coming in the middle. That this is number two of a three-part series. So if you have any questions, you can quiz the women that were here last week. So if I refer to something last week and you don't get it, maybe somebody can help pull the strings together. If you stay the whole 3 months, you'll hear my first lecture just before you leave. Last time we talked about intimacy, and we talked about it in terms of how it relates to chemical dependency. And as we talked about intimacy, we realized that sexuality is one of seven ways that you experience closeness and connectedness with other people, but that it's only one of seven ways. It's not the way, the best way, the only way. We talked last week about how intimacy gets used synonymously with sexuality. In other words, if somebody comes up to you and says, are you having an intimate relationship? What are they asking you? Sleeping with them. And that's a misconception of the word. And in fact, you're probably having some pretty intimate exchanges and developing intimacy here in the house. And hopefully you're not having a sexual relationship. I understand that breaks the rules. But intimacy is certainly a lot bigger than sexuality. Tonight we're going to talk about sexuality and hopefully see it within the context of intimacy that we saw last week. You know, I started out last week by talking about why is intimacy a valid issue to talk about in terms of recovery. And what we said about that is that we're suffering from an intimacy disease, and as long as that's an important part of what our disease is, it's important for us to understand how it works and what we need to do about it. Now, sexuality is also a valid recovery issue, and in case your counselors haven't been able to get this point across to you, your recovery is based on two things. One is figuring out how to be clean and sober, and the second is how to figure out how to be happy, clean, and sober. I mean, if you're not happy, what's the point? This sobriety is a lot of hard work, right? I mean, it's not exactly easy. And if it doesn't bring you happiness, what is the point of all that hard work? So part of what you're going to be figuring out in your recovery is, now that you're sober, what do you need to do to enjoy your life? Well, when I first started training as a sexual health consultant, I went to a lot of classes and heard a lot of speakers, and I remember one of the first ones just about knotting my socks off, because this man got up in front of the medical school and he said, the first thing you need to know about sexuality is the gift from God to help us be happy. Now that was shocking, absolutely shocking to me. I think maybe I said last week that I am also a recovering Catholic. I had had a lot of years of Catholic education, a lot of years of religious education. Nobody had ever bothered to tell me that our sexuality is a gift from God to help us be happy. So in terms of recovery, I think it has a lot to do with it, because it has to do with quality of life and figuring out how to get off this planet with some state of happiness. You know, if you had met me when I was 16 and you had said, Janine, what do you think sexuality is? I probably would have said, well, I'm not really sure, but if you don't watch out, it'll get you. You know, we had a term in the 50s. I was 16 in the 50s, I think, wasn't it? In trouble. And the term in trouble always had to do with sex, right? I mean, that was it. Anyone who was in trouble, they'd do sex. So what I had learned by the time I was 16 was how not to get exploited, how not to lose control in the back seat of a car, how not to let anyone else lose control in the vacuum care. Have you ever noticed as women we were kind of told that the responsibility rested with us? My learned history about men is once they got an erection, their brain turned to mush and I couldn't count on them anymore. You know, that they turned into some kind of howling animal. And I was really relieved, you know, to find out that that really isn't true. That as women, we have the same kind of sexual energy as men have. And that if we're expected to keep the control of ourselves, we can expect them to keep control of themselves. I mean, isn't that liberating? I only have one person to worry about. Ourselves. I can manage that. But if you take care of somebody else, you know, I think, gee, that was a real good example of how my religious training set me up for Al-Anon, told me I was responsible for somebody else's erection. When you talk about codependence. So most of us, if you've been raised in beautiful USA, most of you have this negative indoctrination about sexuality as well as myself. I think it is a cultural phenomenon. Rather than looking at sexuality as something positive, something spiritual, something fun, we look at it as something naughty, dirty, nasty, something we can't talk about, and that if you don't be careful, it'll destroy your life. Now, is it any wonder that this culture is not very well adjusted sexually? I mean, I think it all follows. So hopefully tonight I'm going to share with you some philosophy kinds of things about sexuality. Remember, in my lecture, just like in anybody else's lecture, why? Right? I'm always looking for a man walks in here. I'm not used to you yet. In terms of sexuality, it's really important to look at it for our own recovery and our own well-being. With my lecture, like anybody else's, take what fits and throw away the rest. Okay? Some of what I'm going to say is controversial. You might not like it. It might be opposed to the way you were raised in your community or in your family or in your church. And that's okay. You don't have to buy everything I say. What I would hope, though, is that you wouldn't think you have to mold yourself, but that you would at least give yourself permission to think. The conclusions you draw are yours. But I don't want to tell you how to think about this subject, but I want to encourage you to think about it. And I hope that it will also stimulate you to talk with one another and share some of your own history, your own ideas, and your own fantasies of where you'd like to go in the future with this issue. You know, our sexuality is something all of us have in common, and yet it's the thing we have the most loneliness around. It's the thing we feel the most alienated about, and it's the thing we have the most secrets about. And that seems really sad to me. You know, the one thing that we could nurture each other with, because we can all understand it, because it's a part of all of us, is the one thing we really experience the most isolation. So hopefully my talk tonight will stimulate you to reach out to one another and kind of bridge that loneliness gap. I've got a bunch of cards here, and I haven't looked at them for a while, so I don't know what order they're in. They're my visual aids. Sometimes I think if you hear and see all at the same time, it sticks in your brain better. The first card I want to talk about is a definition of sexuality. Can you all see that? Is that I'll read it for those of you that can't see it. It's not very high. Now, I need to say something about this definition. That this definition that I'm giving you is not a universal truth. It's an evolving definition. And when I meet you maybe in 5 years or 10 years, and if I'm still talking about this stuff, I may have a new definition, because we keep learning about sexuality all the time. when you think about how long we've been studying astrology and the stars, I mean, thousands of years, we know a lot about the universe. We've really only been studying sexuality since the turn of the century, 80 years. So we don't know a whole lot about it. In fact, some of my talks that I gave 5 years ago, I kind of wish I could go back to that audience. Do you remember Emily Latella on Saturday Night Live, where she would go on this big harangue, and she'd go on and go on, and then you realize that she's saying the wrong word or something? She'd go, oh, never mind. I feel like I wish I could go back to some of those groups and say, remember those things I told you about sexuality? Never mind. We learned some new things, and I didn't have it quite right. So I want you to know that what I'm saying tonight, I might not have it quite right, because in another day or week or year, somebody may come up with a whole new discovery. So this is a definition of sexuality that makes sense to me today. That our sexuality, in the broadest sense, is psychic energy that expresses itself physically and emotionally in our need for tenderness, touch, warmth, and love. Now, the reason your mom never told you that your sexuality was psychic energy is because she didn't know that. One of the biggest mistakes we make in this culture is to treat the word sexuality as if it was a verb. Can you remember the definition of a verb?
Action.
An action word. All right. So if you say the word jog, what kind of an image do you get in your head?
Probably
see Barb running down the frontage road in her jogging suit, right? When you say the word sexuality, what do you see?
Stars.
Come on, really? Come on. Rigorous honesty, remember? This is an unusual group. Two people in bed having intercourse, right?
All right,
copulation. That's another word for it. Screwing, isn't it? That if you ask that to a group of people, 90% will see an action, just like jogging. They will see two people having intercourse. Now that's a myth. Your sexuality is not something that you do, it's something that you have. It's a noun. What's the definition of a noun?
Person.
You got it. And so we've got it. It's a thing, and we've got it inside us. It runs through our body like our bloodstream runs through our body. It's an energy. It's part of our life force. It's part of our personality. What's really fun is to think that it's the part of us that leaves this earth when we die. Our sexuality goes with us. All we leave here is the body. We get to take that energy with us. You are a sexual being from birth to death, maybe before and maybe after. We have a popular idea in this culture that you're sexual somewhere between the ages of 14 and 15. So if as a kid you're too sexually curious in your parents' eyes, or if you have sexual questions to ask or interest, a lot of times parents take their kids off to child psychologists and say, what's the matter with him or her? Something definitely wrong. They shouldn't be thinking about this stuff now. And if you're interested in sexuality after the age of 50, what are we dubbed?
Dirty old men,
kinky old ladies, perverts, weirdos. Well, I want you to know, the good news is there's no such thing. And that you're going to care about your sexuality for as long as you breathe. We've been doing research to try to eliminate birth defects. So there's been a lot of study of the womb and the fetus and how it develops and what affects the fetus. And we've learned some interesting things in trying to study the development of the child. But we've learned that even when that baby is in mom's womb, if it's a male child, by the time it's fully developed, it begins having erections in mother's womb. No, I said that to a group of women, and one of them said, oh, I thought that was kicking. Babies also kick. If the fetus develops into a female, after it is fully developed, it begins lubricating. So the vaginal linings begin lubricating in mom's womb. So even before you and I let out that first squeal, at least from a physiological point of view, we were sexually alive.
Who told you that? I mean, told you that yourself.
Well, we know this because of research around the development of the fetus. For when they're trying to figure out how to eliminate birth defects, we have all kinds of equipment now that can monitor the development of the fetus. So we can see inside and hear inside and know things that we never could know before. So I learned this stuff from the medical school. But it certainly makes the case for the fact that there is no special time in life when you're sexual. That you are sexual because you're here and because you're alive. And that energy is flowing through your body. Now, the big question is, what are you going to do with the energy? Just like the big question of recovery is, what are you going to do with your life? That's all up for grabs. And what you and I do with our sexual energy depends a lot upon how we were raised, how old we are, whether we have a partner or not, whether we're straight or gay, whether we're male or female, whether we've been traumatized or not. So part of the task of recovery for you and I is to figure out, first of all, what that sexual energy means in us to understand us a little bit better, and then to figure out what we're going to do about it. Because we express that energy in how we feel and what we do. We also express it in how we think. I'm going to talk about that in a little bit. But the whole idea of tenderness, touch, warmth, and love is going to be important to us our whole lives. In fact, a lot of the reason that you and I are in recovery is because we didn't get enough of the tenderness, touch, warmth, and love that we needed to develop a good sense of ourselves. If something wasn't flowing right with that sexual energy in our family, and we didn't know how to raise kids who value themselves and respect themselves, a lot of times the repercussions of that is chemical pain. So reclaiming that sexual energy and figuring out how to handle it for yourself is a big part of getting well. I think out of tenderness, touch, warmth, and love, the most important word there, I believe, is touch, because it's the least subjective. And many of us will encounter touch issues in our recovery. It's not at all uncommon for me to meet people in treatment or early recovery that tell me they have never been touched in any other way than a punitive disciplinary way. And so they get into a sexual situation and they don't know what to do about that. That touch is too scary, too painful. Now, maybe you ran into people in treatment who were real uncomfortable with hugs, or who didn't really know how to express their affection or their tenderness through touch. That's not unusual. Most of us came from rather dysfunctional crowds and didn't know how to teach us that stuff. It's really important to become aware of what your issues are around touch, and to be very respectful of other people. I make it a point in my private practice not to hug anybody or touch anybody without permission. And my clients who've been sexually abused have really helped me understand that when I do touch them and I haven't asked permission, I violate them the same way they've been violated in their lives, and it makes it very hard for them to trust me. Yeah.
On that, have you found many of your patients that have some kind of a touch issue, you know, it doesn't have to do with sexual abuse, but just that aspect. Do you find that people with their recovery, they don't have their sexuality, they don't have sex?
I don't think I'm saying it the right way, but as they go down the line,
you know, do you find them becoming more, you know, like out to be able to touch them?
Yeah, I think if that's one of the goals that they're setting for themselves, absolutely. It's just, if you've never learned how to ride, I had a friend of mine that moved here from the Bronx at the age of 35. He had never learned how to ride a bike. And he lived by Lake Harriet, and he was bound and determined to learn how to ride a bike. And I'm telling you, I never realized how hard it is to learn that as an adult, because it's so easy for us when we're 4 and 5. But he had more bruised elbows and bloody knees than any human being I'd ever seen. I really congratulated him when he figured out how to master that 10 speed, because he nearly killed himself. But he was determined and he learned it. And I think that goes for us around any of our recovery issues, including touch. If we want to learn it bad enough, if we want to get past whatever blocks us, we are capable of doing it. I believe in recovery.
Well, I guess my question is, to be sexual identity, you can be a touch but not, to me, you know, I understand what you're saying, and I can see where you have an issue with touch, but I'm saying, to me, sexuality, you don't have to be touchable, that touchable, you don't have to be overly touchable.
No.
I'm not saying it the right way, I'm just...
I think that the comfort with touch, the wanting to touch, the spontaneity of touch varies from person to person. And it's a vehicle to express your sexual energy. So the more open that is for you, probably the easier that energy is going to flow. Now, that may be more or less difficult. I came from a real confusing family. My mother was a Finlander and my dad was a Frenchman. But in terms of learning about touch, I come from two cultures that are diametrically opposed. You know, one touches all the time and the other one rarely touches. So, you know, I kind of had a potpourri. I could pick out of those two things what I wanted. So, but if you come perhaps from a very Scandinavian family that isn't very physical, your issues around touch are maybe going to be a little tougher than an Italian family who could really get it out and be very effervescent and affectionate. I think it's a very personal issue. And it what may be a problem for one person may not be a problem for another. The bottom line is, do you like how you are and is it working for you? It's interesting how touchers marry non-touchers, and dancers marry non-dancers. Have you ever noticed that? I mean, what a drag. But we seem to do that in order to learn something from one another. And it's a real potential for learning. The problem is most of us get real ornery and we try to change the other one to be like us rather than to move towards the middle and learn from each other. Our sexual energy exists in our minds, our feelings, our body, and our behavior. And sexual health is about harmony and congruity in these areas. It means being fully alive in your body. Now, people have wondered what sexual health was for a long, long time. You know, we started studying sexuality because people had problems. We assumed that everything would naturally be all right for people. But that really is a false assumption. Remember how you learn in treatment, if you take the word assume and crack it up, it makes an ass of you and me. You know what the odds of being raised in this culture and being sexually healthy are? I mean, they're about zip. We don't have a very sexually healthy culture. So many of us have wondered, well, what would it mean to be sexually healthy? Some people think, well, if you have 8 orgasms, that means you're real healthy. If you have, 10 partners, that means you're real healthy. Now, if you can maintain an erection for over 25 minutes, you're real healthy. And we've had these unusual barometers for trying to measure sexual health. And what I'd like you to know is that you can be a celibate person, someone who's decided not to express their sexuality erotically. You can be married, single, old, young, and still be sexually healthy. What it means is that you are in balance inside yourself, that you harmonize, that your mind and your feeling and your body and behavior all work together in a way that you can feel good about who you are. We're going to talk more about that as we go along. So a six-year-old who's running outside and jumps in the grass and rolls down a hill and feels really good about it is expressing their sexual energy and probably being very healthy about it. You know, the little kid who gets their hand slapped for masturbating and sent to their room and punished is probably not feeling very healthy about their sexuality because they got a bunch of conflict. Their mind says, mom says it wrong, it's wrong, it must be wrong because moms are always right. Their feelings say, I feel ashamed, embarrassed, confused. When I touch myself, it feels really good. How could something that feels good be bad like mom says it is? They begin to feel ashamed and angry at their body because their body keeps kind of beckoning to do this again and again. And their behavior is real erratic. One day they'll masturbate, the next day they'll say, no, I'm going to be a good kid. And I remember people telling me stories about promising God they'll never masturbate again if they'll get their bicycle they want for Christmas. They didn't bargain with it. Because they feel so shameful and guilty about it that maybe if they make a bargain or there's a special reward, they'll be able to be or do what they think they're supposed to be and be. What you have then is a little kid who's not very sexually healthy because they're not harmonizing. Let me give you a grown-up example. The man from 5232 and the woman from 5230 begin having an affair. They're both married to somebody else. They grew up believing in their minds that adultery or extramarital relations is wrong. Their feelings are all confused. It feels good, they feel ashamed, they feel excited, they feel angry, they feel scared. Their body is saying yes, yes, their mind is saying no, no. And their behavior is one day it's all over, you never see them again, and the next day they're passionately in the sack again. And what you have there is a very sexually unhealthy person because they're all mixed up inside themselves. There's no judgment on the behavior. If you came from another culture, like if you're an Eskimo, and a way of saying thank you to the man next door is to offer your wife, then in their mind they think it's really a way of showing hospitality. Their feelings go far out. This is better than a thank you note. You know, their bodies feel okay with it. Their behavior is in line with their values and beliefs, and so they're sexually healthy about it. You see the difference? I really don't know. I think it's just a gesture.
Right.
And it isn't fraught with what does this mean and all of that.
So
but I'm saying is that when a person is not okay with what's going on, they're in a state of ill sexual health. If they are okay and they're in harmony in mind, body, and feelings, they are in a state of sexual
health.
Yeah.
Not with what's going on with everything.
That's right. It's very hard to do that in this culture because we've got so many rules. And many of us don't get a chance to figure out whether we want to buy all the rules or not. you know, they're just kind of dumped on us, we're supposed to make them work for ourselves. I think one of the things that each of us has to do in our recovery is what kind of rules do we want? Figure that out for ourselves. What's right for us? Okay. How can we live with ourselves in this culture? Yeah?
Okay, if you find your moral balance and what you feel is right and wrong, but let's say you still technically attracted to the name of marriage. So
that just means you're human.
Right. Okay. Well, are you sexually unhealthy because you can't?
No, well, unless you believe that feeling that way is bad. You know, and I'm going to talk about this in a little while, but I was taught that an impure thought was as bad as an impure deed. Remember when poor Carter lusted in his heart, and the article in Playboy came out? Everybody felt so sorry for you. To tell you the truth, the way I see it, Jimmy Carter's just a human being. And we'll talk about that. But a lot of it has to do with what you believe. You believe... you know, a lot of us grew up in families where we believed if you had a negative feeling, you were a bad person. You could only feel happy feelings, right? If you had a bad feeling, you were a bad girl. So a lot of us spent a whole lot of our lives trying not to feel the whole other half of the feeling spectrum, and only being half a person. I'll talk about this some more, but I just hope you get the idea that sexual health is a very personal thing. Nobody can say to you what you need to be sexually healthy other than that you have to feel good and agree with how you're conducting your life.
And there's some people that feel good about it and they tell you it's wrong.
Well, that's their problem.
Good.
Yep, their problem. I don't think we have the right to do that for one another. Okay, our sexual responses are on a continuum. And this is important to know, that from shaking a hand to having intercourse is a whole continuum of sexual response. What you have down here is warmth. That can be expressed in smiles and twinkly eyes and winks and waves. In tones of voice, have you ever noticed how some people have such a warm tone in their voice that you hear them and you automatically just feel kind of comfy? You can express that. That is an expression of warmth. Affection can be verbal or physical. You can say, gee, I really like you a lot. Had a fun day with you. Thanks for the movie. It was really fun. That dinner was great. You can hug. Shaking hands can be an expression of both warmth and affection. Hug. Nurturing. Often things like bathing. Bathing someone. Back rubs. Massage. Patching knees or you know, have you ever been in a, I think for us women, there's such a difference between how we experience an OBGYN exam, depending on the sensitivity of the person giving it. I mean, it can almost feel nurturing with someone who really treasures you and treats you very carefully, and it can feel almost abusive with someone who doesn't give a rip. So we can experience being cared about in a nurturing way. Sensuousness. Sensuous massage is different than therapeutic massage, the psychic massage. You can experience all kinds of sexual feelings through taste, touch, smell. A lot of us that are chemically dependent have really put our senses to sleep. And the longer you stay sober, the more you're going to smell, the more you're going to see, the more you're going to touch, the more alive you're going to get in your body. And what that means is that that energy is flowing again. And it's really a positive sign. Some people get real scared. You know, oh, we're going to get out of control. But we really don't. No, it's just, we're just not used to being alive. And your senses are a wonderful way to experience quality of life. Eroticism is where we really feel turned on. Women lubricate, men get erections, we get a blush on our face, our breathing changes, our pulse rate changes, our fantasies change. And then transcendence. Well, transcendence, I wish I knew more about. I think I'm too young to have transcendence very many times. I think transcendence is a spiritual part of sexuality that perhaps we experience more in the second half of life. But I can kind of give you a sense of what I think it is. And maybe this has happened to you. I know it's happened to me a few times. Where you have one of those days that you wake up and everything is going right, and you feel really good about yourself, your own energy's flowing, and you're feeling really good, and you run into somebody else, and they're feeling really good about who they are, and maybe you go out, and maybe you have a good time, and you go back, and you decide to be sexual with one another, and it's really a celebration about how good you feel about yourself, and how good you feel about the other person. And at the end of that encounter, there's kind of a sense that all is right, that God is in her heaven, and the universe is turning just the way it's supposed to, and that there's kind of a peace, a connectedness not only inside yourself, but with the person you're with, and also with your God. Now, some of the places where I felt that the most is on the back of a motorcycle with my former husband, going through mountains. That I was okay with me, he was okay with him, we were wonderful together, and God was with us. I think those are spiritual kinds of transcendence where our sexual energy reminds us that we're part of something bigger than ourselves and bigger than this planet. So hopefully as we get older and wiser, we'll work towards more of that transcendence with our sexual energy. But most of us look too young to know a whole lot about all that yet. It's something to look forward to, I think. Also, it's really important as we get to understand our sexual energy better to know where we draw these lines. One line that is absolutely clear to me, and clear as a cultural rule, is that we never, ever, ever express our erotic feelings with children. That we can't use children to deal with our eroticism. That's not okay. There may be certain relationships you don't want to be sensuous in. It doesn't feel comfortable. So you may stop the interactions at different points depending on where you are and who you're with and what feels right to you. Sexuality is an integral part of everybody's personality, and we express it in everything that we do. I think I've been talking a lot about that up to this point, but just to make it a little clearer, you're expressing your sexual energy in how you sit, how you dress, how you hug, how you talk. As you live in community here, I don't know if you've taken the risk to ask one another about your sexuality or try to understand one another's sexuality, but I guarantee you, you've been sizing each other up and wondering about one another. And that most of how we do that is non-verbally. So people pick up clues about you all the time and they try to guess, well, I wonder what goes on with them sexually. I wonder how good they feel about themselves. And, you know, you may wonder, I wonder if they're fun in bed. And you may wonder about all kinds of things. Because we have a culture that doesn't talk about sexuality, we have to try to guess. Which makes it really hard. That's why I kind of hope as we all get healthier, we're going to start talking so the guesswork doesn't get so tough. I mean, if you can start communicating, you cut down the margin of error. Understanding and taking responsibility for our sexuality can be a positive force throughout our life. And that's really important. In other words, what we're saying is if you can understand your sexuality, and if you're willing to take responsibility for it, remember, recovery means self-responsibility, that there's a Benny in that, you're going to have a happier life. There's something in it to do this stuff. Now, when I graduated from high school in 1958, my mom told me to go out and be sexually responsible. What do you think she meant? Hey, yeah, you knew my mom. Somebody knew my mom. They said, don't do it. In the 50s, it was really simple. Sexual responsibility meant abstinence from everything. I remember once driving in the car, I think I was 16, I was riding next to my boyfriend and my mother was sitting by the door. Now, I had grown up in a family where if you rode in the car with mom and dad, no way were you going to wedge yourself between them. Mother always sat next to dad. She always had her arm up around the back of the seat. And none of us kids could weasel our way in between. That was just how they were with each other. So that was my role model. If you ever wonder where you got your sex education, look at your parents. That's it, folks. For better or for worse, they were your primary educators. And most of what we learned was by watching. So I emulated what I saw. And as we're driving along, I had my hand on my boyfriend's thigh. Well, I got home and my mother grabbed me by the arm, whisked me off to the kitchen, and said, Janine, please, don't put your hand on Bob's thigh. And I said, but Mom, why? Well, it'll make him very uncomfortable. I didn't have the faintest idea what she was talking about. Of course, you have to understand, I was 16 in a Catholic all-girls school. I was, you know, definitely sexually repressed. I didn't have very much information. Now, what do you think my mom was worried about? Now that we're older and wiser, we can kind of analyze Mom. What was she worried about? Yeah. Well, what would happen? His head would turn to mush and he'd attack me, right? So I wasn't supposed to do anything that would arouse him. And that's what sexual responsibility was, not to do anything arousing. Well, how boring is that? I mean, it takes all the fun out of it. You know, it makes you wonder whether it's even okay to express warmth and affection, because how do you know when warmth and affection might be arousing to somebody? Well, one of the nice things about living through the 60s is that the whole idea of sexual responsibility enlarged. And there still is a group of people in this culture that believe affection and eroticism belong in marriage. But there are also a variety of other views running around this world. And maybe you've ran into some of them. I was listening to Phil Donahue one day, and they had three sets of three people that they were interviewing. And what they had there was three-way relationships. One was two women and a man. The other, I think it was two, with two women and one man. And then one was two men and one woman. And they were talking about how they had a marriage, which is a three-way marriage. And that even though it wasn't legal, it was very important to them. And they talked about how they were negotiating it and how it worked for them and why they thought it was a groovy option. Now, in the 50s, if that had been on television, everybody would freak. Okay, because if people were doing that, they sure didn't talk about it. We have people who are thinking about sexual expression and friendship because we have a large group of our culture today that don't want to marry, men and women. They want a single lifestyle. They like being single. And so the question is, well, if you're going to have a single lifestyle, what do you do with your sexual energy? And how do you express your eroticism? So many of them are thinking about, well, I wonder if I had a loving friend who I from time to time sleep with in a responsible, safe way, would that be okay for me? And they're experimenting with that. My son came up with a wonderful idea the other day. He's from a divorced family, but he's real sensitive about this stuff. He said, Mom, I think I got it figured out how we're going to do this. when I fall in love with a relationship, we'll see how it feels. If it still feels good and if it still feels important, we'll get married and have kids. And all I could say to him is, well, good luck, honey. I mean, there's as good a chance it's going to work better than what Dad and I did. You know, but there's no sure way that that's going to work. But the point I'm trying to make, in 1987, we have the freedom to try to be creative and come up with new ways to make our life work. There isn't just one way of being sexually responsible. The world is not that homogenized. So each of you will kind of have to sort this out for yourself. Because what happened in the 60s, the one right way kind of got thrown out the window and the door opened for about 50 right ways. Or 50 possible ways. Or 100 possible ways to live as a sexual being and be respectful to yourself and others. If you had to give a lecture tomorrow night to the house on sexual responsibility, and you can assume, now I know there are women from all over the country here, there are women from very religious families, maybe women from families that weren't religious, it looks like there's a lot of different ethnic groups here, so you can't assume we're all little peas in the same pod, right? So if you had to talk about sexual responsibility to this group of women, what would you want to be sure was in your lecture? Okay, the right to be an individual and to figure this out for yourself. I think that'd be real important. What else?
Freedom of choice.
Pardon me?
Freedom of choice.
Freedom of choice. That kind of fits in with being
birth control.
Birth control. That's a wonderful thing to talk about. It's really important. You know, what's really interesting is that in this generation of teenagers, they are absolutely the best educated about birth control of any other generation ahead of us. And do you know that the illegitimate birth rate keeps rising? Why do you think that is? Yeah, talk up.
Fear of abuse.
That's part of it.
They admitting and acceptance that they're having sex.
You bet. We have a lot of denial because we can't talk about it in the open. You know, many of us in our families thought that maybe that we didn't have to face alcoholism if we never said Dad's a drunk. You know what these kids don't know how to do? They don't know how to talk about it. They go on a date and nobody knows how to say who's got the rubber or what do we do from birth control or are you on the pill?
Everybody assumes the evidence taken care of.
Or they're scared. They're scared to take care of themselves. They're scared to bridge the gap and talk about something that isn't talked about.
Also denial, it'll never happen to me.
Right, a lot of denial. Because we've got so many secrets. What?
You're afraid to say no, too.
Afraid to say no. Right,
you know, Who do they go to? They can't talk to their parents. Some of them can.
Well, the point is that today there are more resources for kids to talk than there have ever been in the history of time, and the kids don't use them.
They're still scared.
They're still scared.
They'll be said it's wrong.
Or they'll be shamed or whatever. So one of the things, if you're going to be sexually responsible, it's not enough to just educate yourself about birth control. You have to start talking about it. And taking it, right. So what else? You got birth control, individuality, freedom of choice, the ability to say no. Yeah, but we need to get specific. All these things are about responsibility. So what specific things?
Your boundaries.
Your boundaries, right. What's right for you? And can you say, this isn't right for me and I don't want to do it? What about if you're in the heat of a passionate necking session and the next thing would be intercourse, but at the end of that necking session you go, no, that was really fun and that's all I want. Can you set a boundary there? A lot of people can't do that. That's a boundary issue. I want you to know you have the right to. You have the right to set a boundary at any point. I mean, how many headlines have you read, man dies through interrupted sexual
emotionally maybe he dies, but physically
alone. Nobody dies of an unused erection, no matter
matter what they have. We'll talk about that a little more next week when we talk more about physiology and nuts and bolts, but that really is a myth. Okay? Well, in respect to time, I'm going to give you a couple other pointers. If you're going to give a sexual responsibility talk, for God's sake, you better talk about AIDS and sexually communicated diseases. You better start defining what safe sex is. It would be interesting to talk about if there really is such a thing as safe sex. I mean, I think we're all kind of playing Russian roulette these days. You need to be able to talk about basic physiology. Do you know how your body works sexually? You know, I can share with you that I was 30 years old before I knew I had a clitoris. I'd been married 10 years and delivered 4 kids. I mean, give me a break. When I found out what I had there, was I angry? Aw. I mean, I wasted all those years not knowing about my own anatomy. If you're heterosexual, it helps to understand how men work. I work with a lot of women who have unfounded fears about erected penises. I keep telling them a penis is only as good or bad as the person it's attached to. It doesn't have a separate life of its own. It seems to. And that if you understand some basic physiology around men, you can get over a lot of fears. Most of what's scary is what we don't understand. So you have to have a basic knowledge of your own physiology, what works for women, what it's all about to be a woman. And if you're heterosexual, it helps to know how men work. Now, the interesting part of that is that you can have a general overview, but you have to leave room for individual differences. You know, what may work real well in Fridley might not work in Bloomington, you know. People are unique and special and different. And you have some general guidelines, but if you really want to know how a person works, you have to ask them. Okay, and if you want to know what a person likes, you have to ask them. So, the point I'm trying to make is sexual responsibility is pretty complicated, isn't it? I mean, it's not something you think about for an hour and you get it all figured out. My guess is you're going to have to keep working on this probably till you croak. Especially with all the new information coming out and all the talk about AIDS. And I think you're going to have to be responsible to yourself and learn all that you can learn. Sex and sexuality are natural functions. They are innate, they're a part of our essential nature, and they can be helped by information and experience. I just want to point out something really quick. You and I have a couple of other natural functions. One is the ability to eat, and the other is the process of using the toilet every day. If you're alive and well, you urinate and defecate every day, right? So, those are natural functions. Your sexual energy and how it gets expressed is a natural function. My mom told me that. She said, Janine, it's natural and wonderful, and someday you'll know all about it. I kept waiting. We treat it differently than we treat other natural functions. You started being educated on how to eat from very soon after you popped out of the womb. That mom and the nurse and you as a baby got together and began trying to figure out how to breastfeed. And then you went maybe from the breast to the bottle and from the bottle to the cup with the little cover on it, you know, so you don't spill your milk all the time. Hopefully by the time you were 3 years old, you could go to Perkins without humiliating your family. In my house, when you're the age of 7, you got a steak knife. It was kind of a rite of passage. You could cut your own meat. It kind of meant you were a big kid now. And if you want to study nutrition today, you can go to B. Dalton. There's a whole section of books on nutrition. You can educate yourself on that natural function till you're blue in the face. Same with using the toilet. If you've had kids of your own, you remember toilet training, right?
It's something you don't forget because you put a lot of time and energy into it. If you didn't have kids of your own, go ask your parents. They'll tell you all kinds of stories they remember about toilet training. Some of you are here will hear, oh, Mom and Dad thought you were a genius because you were trained by 11 months. And others will say, Mom and Dad are really worried about you because you didn't train for 11 years. But they remember because a lot of time and energy went into that. But then we say sex is a natural function, you don't need to know anything about it. Now how crazy is that? It is terrible. You know, when I was giving this lecture to a large group of people, a man in the audience raised his hand and said, Janine, for thousands and thousands and thousands of years we've been treating sex as a natural function and nobody had any education and the species has continued to survive. Why are you saying that now in 1987 we should do something different? Well, I'll tell you why I think we should do something different. Because you and I didn't have the kind of training we needed around that natural function. Most of us fell in love or got attracted to someone and we decided that we would try to figure it out, and in that process we got traumatized. I'm in my office 4 days a week from 8 to 5:30. 80% of what I hear every day is stories about sexual trauma. Now I'm talking about clinical trauma. What I mean by clinical trauma is that trauma has two components to it. One is that a person was not emotionally, intellectually, physically prepared for what happened to them. So they go into a state of shock. Their whole system shocks out. If you've ever been in an automobile accident or observed somebody who had an accident and went into shock, you know what that's like. Sometimes sexual trauma, people can walk around in a shock for years. I had a client who was raped and didn't come to see me till a year and a half later because she didn't think about it until she was standing behind her pharmacy counter and the guy came up to get a prescription. And then she remembered. She had been in a coma for a year and a half about that. That's how long shock can last.
You don't know you're in shock or
not? No, you just keep functioning.
You block it out.
You just shut down. The other thing about a trauma is that it alters how you feel about yourself and the world. You're walking along the street, you feel good about yourself, you like people, you think women are great, you think men are great. You walk past an alley, somebody grabs you, pulls you in the alley, rapes you. All of a sudden you feel horseshit about yourself. You never want to see another man. You take 14 baths a day because you can't get the sense of dirty off you. It alters how you feel about yourself, how you feel about other people you inhabit the planet with. And your path in life was going like this, and all of a sudden you're making a left-hand turn. If that trauma isn't intervened, a person could go through the next 40 years thinking they're a bad person, thinking there's something wrong with them, thinking they're spoiled, soiled, whatever. Thinking no men can be trusted.
Who would have think the other way, that they deserved it?
Or that they deserved it if they hadn't been walking there, or if they hadn't been wearing that dress. Well, first of all, I want you to know, no human being on this planet, even if they were walking down Fifth Avenue nude, deserves to be raped. There is nothing that any of us can do that we deserve any kind of abuse. There are no grounds for that. So what I want to say about sexuality is a natural function is, yes, it is a natural function, and I'm really thrilled about that. But I think we need to have some training and education around it so that we know how to avoid being traumatized and that we don't get injured around that part of who we are. About this is the whole issue of education. You may find that you are chronologically an adult female, but that you may have sexual information that's about the level of a 10-year-old, and that happens a lot. We have another myth in this country that after you're the age of 16, you should no longer have to ask a sexual question. Okay? I mean, come on, how many of you laughed at jokes that you didn't understand because you didn't want anyone to know you didn't understand it? I mean, I've done that a million times. I was giving a talk to a singles group one night, and I was talking about sexual health, and thank God it was a big enough room and I couldn't see this person, but after the talk was over, he came up to me, and it was a guy that I had known in junior high. And he said, "Janine, I can't believe you're doing this. This is the right. Does your mother know you're doing this?" That was his first question. And I said, "Yeah, Mom's got trouble with it, but she's accepting it." And he said, "You know what cracks me up is that I'm the one that used to explain all the dirty jokes to you in the kitchen. Now look at you." You know. And that's true. Now, maybe if you had a special buddy, you could say, "What does that mean?" Well, I want you to know if there are some things that you don't know, you better start asking. This is a critical issue. You can't afford to be ignorant. I do sex education groups for adult women in my private practice. You know what the average age is? Yes.
35.
And you know what that correlates with? There's this myth, it's a myth, that men peak sexually from 16 to 25 and women peak sexually from 35 to 40 or 45. That's a myth. You know why the average age in my group is 35? Because that's how long it takes for a woman to get pissed.
What do you mean?
Well, she's really tired of not knowing what's going on. And when I do the intake interviews, then I say, "Well, why do you want to come to this group?" And I say, "Because I'll tell you what. You know, I'm not getting anywhere, not knowing anything. I'm not having any fun. I don't know what to do. I can't find anybody to ask the questions of, and I'm really tired of it." Usually by the time we're 35, we're mature enough to say we don't know. And you should watch these women work. They're dynamite. It's the most fun thing I do professionally. They laugh together, they cry together, they explore together, and they heal one another. It's wonderful. And it has nothing to do with sexual peaking. You know, my hope is that you and I are multiple peakers, that we're going to keep peaking. Oh, by the time we're 60, it's going to be better than when we were 30.
All right.
Yeah. It's natural to have sexual feelings and fantasies. We're not responsible for having the feelings, but we are responsible for what we do with the feelings. Now, that's controversial. A lot of religions actually preach that what you think is as bad as what you do. From a psychological point of view, it doesn't make any sense to me at all. I believe you and I are going to be ultimately judged by our higher power, by our brothers and sisters on the planet, and by our own rigorous self-honesty based on what we do in this lifetime, not what we feel. It is human to feel hate. It is human to feel jealousy. It is human to feel revenge. It is human to feel horny. It is human to feel glad, happy. And there are a million options and how to express those feelings. Now, not all that long ago, I haven't recovered quite yet, found out that my ex had fallen in love. And first of all, how dare he fall in love before I did? What a louse. I also wanted to claw her eyes out. Doesn't make any sense. I asked for the divorce. Feelings are not rational. Okay? Now, if I had gone and clawed her eyes out, I'd be in big trouble. The fact that I felt that way only means I'm human. So it's how you act on your feelings that you're going to be held accountable for. A lot of chaplains in treatment ask me, what can we say to people who feel guilty about their sexual fantasies? I can tell them they're human. Human beings have sexual fantasies. It's a part of being creative. It's a part of testing ourselves and wondering about life. We do that in our fantasy life. One of the exercises I have our women do in the sexuality group is that everybody goes home and writes an anonymous fantasy. And then we come back, we put them all in the middle of the floor and mix them up. Everybody grabs one and we read them. It's one of the most liberating things that we do for one another. We find out some people are real boring fantasizers, others are real wonderful fantasizers. You know, what sounds real good to one person doesn't sound at all good to another. Some people ask me, if I think it, if I wonder about it, does that mean I want to do it? And what I say to them, I don't know, does that mean you want to do it? You're the authority about that. Nobody else can know that. A lot of times when I throw it back to the person and say, I don't know, do you want to do that? They say, no, it's much more fun thinking about it. I would never want to do it. I say, well, then there's your answer. I think a lot of times we read in psychology books, if you think something you really want to do, well, you know, I like to sew. It's kind of something that I do for recreation. And I go to the fabric store and I look through pattern books and I look at all the patterns and I wonder how they're going to look on my shape and how my body is and will it be flattering or won't it be flattering or whatever. I may try on 15 dresses in my head. But I usually only buy one pattern and one hunk of fabric and go home with it. I don't do everything I think about. I can be walking through Dayton's and one of my favorite men colognes is Paco Rabanne. And if somebody's, a gentleman is walking past me and they've got Paco Rabanne on, I mean, I stop in my tracks. I usually have a flood of wonderful memories and I go on about my shopping. Now, who did that hurt? Nobody. In fact, it was actually kind of pleasant.
Well, what if you, you know, like you? I know.
Now, if I turned around and chased the guy down the aisle, and he said, "Where is that?" You know,
what's the sanctuary?
You know, I may get myself into trouble. I think we are all capable of thinking whatever we want. You know, my guess is that all of you have had sexual fantasies since I started this lecture. And look how well you've all behaved.
Some of us.
No, I think you've been great. The bottom line is, what really matters is what we do in our lives. And that you need to be accountable for your behavior. We all have the right to know about the range of human sexual behavior and be acquainted with the most current information about sexuality. That was the part I thought I had lost. Actually, I've been on panels where we've debated the pros and cons of sex education, and I'm sure you know where I stand. When I listen to people who are against it, what I hear is that knowledge is harmful, that if you tell people about it, they're going to go crazy in the streets. And my experience and research experience says that isn't true at all. There's a researcher from Syracuse University by the name of Saul Gordon. And what he found out, he did a lot of different sex education research projects with adolescents. And what he found out is the kids with the most comprehensive education, where they actually got information and got a chance to talk and ask questions and explore values, those kids had fewer sexual experiences, but the ones they had more fun. And you know why that would be? They know what they're doing, right? So they're not as scared and they don't get traumatized, but they're also educated. So they, you know how many things we did because we didn't know that we could blame it on naivete or the beer or the grass or whatever? That we didn't ever have to take responsibility. We could just be kind of these, you know, little zombies that walk through life and sex happened to us. Once you're educated, you fall from innocence. It's just like your alcoholism. If anyone in this room decides to go back to using, I want you to know this experience has wrecked it for you. It's never going to feel like it did before because you're too smart. You know too much. Somebody spit in your soup. Not going to taste the same. That's also true with sex education. The more educated you are, the more you know, the more you think, and the more you question and decide, is this what I want or not what I want? Now, sometimes it's kind of a pain in the tush. Oftentimes I wish that I could go back to those good old innocent days when I didn't know about alcoholism. Because when I go out in the world, I see a lot of it, and it breaks my heart. It hurts. I also can't go take care of my pain that way anymore. It doesn't work as well. So I really am an advocate of learning everything you need to know so you can make good decisions. Shame and guilt. Shame and guilt need not be associated with sexuality. For those of us that are recovering, we're gold medalists at it. We can feel shame and guilt about just about anything. And sexuality is really loaded. Because sexuality is treated covertly in this culture, it's been associated with badness. The biggest question that comes into my office in all kinds of shapes and forms and sizes is, am I normal? None of us won't know if we're normal because we never get to talk to anybody else about it. If we explore our sexual attitudes and obtain correct information about sex, we can free ourselves from shame and guilt. And I'll tell you what, the more shame and guilt you can free yourself from, the happier recovery you're going to have. You don't need it. It serves no useful purpose. Sometimes just asking a simple question can relieve 20 years of guilt. You know, it's interesting. My daughter used to play with Barbie dolls all the time. And, you know, Barbie dolls are those little 10-inch dolls that are just perfect. They have perfect hair and perfect fingernails and perfect clothes and a swimming pool and Ken and a camper and
a kid.
You know, I mean, she's got everything. And one day Jill came out and said, Mom, she called her breast boobs. When my boobs get big, will my nipples disappear like Barbie's? Now, can you see how her logic worked? Barbie's got everything except nipples. They must not be good because Barbie's got everything that's good. If you notice, Barbie and Ken also don't have genitals. They're real masculine together, aren't they?
That's how they get stiffer.
I think that it was important for me to explain to my daughter that no, in fact, her nipples would get more prominent. They would get bigger instead of disappear. And that they're very important to her because they feel good and because she'll nurse her children with them. And when she said, well, why doesn't Barbie have any? I said, well, I think Mattel has a problem with it. Someone from the program in human sexuality wrote Mattel.
Oh my
said,
God.
How come you don't have anatomically correct dolls? And they said, we do. We ship them all to Europe. In Europe, it's okay to have genitals on your doll. In this country, we pretend like they don't exist. The whole culture. You know, it's interesting. In terms of sex education for women, most women don't know anything about their genital makeup because they've been told it's not nice to look, touch, smell, or taste. And so that's kind of the part of their body they never make friends with. Men, on the other hand, know everything about their genitals, but they have no idea about the erotic possibilities of their earlobes. So you have genitally focused men and body focused women trying to have sex together. What a mess. You know, you wonder how we made it this far, don't you? Okay, last but not least. One of the things we do in our sex education group is that the women write a letter that starts out, Dear Genitals. And they talk about how they feel about it. And then if they're really brave, the genitals write a letter back. We come and we read it. I want you to know that there's some of those letters that have brought tears to my eyes. I mean, they are the most moving, touching statements of how we feel about ourselves. We all have the right to our own beliefs and convictions about sexuality. What is acceptable sexually will vary from person to person. We have a responsibility to ourselves and others to not be exploitive. Hopefully in our recovery we can learn to respect ourselves and not exploit ourselves. Anytime you do something sexually that you don't want to do, you're exploiting yourself. And I hope you won't do that anymore. You deserve better treatment. Hopefully we won't exploit others. People who say I love you to get sex when they don't really mean it are exploiting. People who say I'll leave you if I don't get what I want, but you're just threatening, are exploiting. Parents who say your sexuality has to be just like mine or you can't be a member of this family are exploiting. Teachers who say there's only one way to think about this subject are exploiting. Heterosexuality is the only way to be is an exploitive statement. You have to be careful about all this stuff. Especially for you and I that are in the program. You may go to a meeting, either AA, Al-Anon, Adult Children of Alcoholics, Narcotics Anonymous, and somebody may need to talk about a sexual issue. If it's something you don't agree with, if it's something you don't understand, if it's something that frightens you, maybe you need to just take a deep breath, say a prayer, and listen. You have another option, which is to share from your own personal experience. It's a very comforting thing. Remember the first time you heard another woman talk about her using, and she sounded like you, and you went, thank God I'm not alone? We can do that around sexuality, too. What happens that's so hurtful is that oftentimes when a person musters up all their courage to talk about something sexual, the group laughs or scowls or an uncomfortable silence happens. So my hope is that each of you will make a contribution when you go to your group to make it a safe place to talk about sexuality and recovery. Because someone may need to talk that day to stay sober for the next 24 hours. And you and I have a responsibility to create an atmosphere that's non-judgmental, that's loving, tell you that most of what I've learned about sexuality that I truly value has come from women like you, who have had the guts to come in and be honest and share what your thoughts were, what your behavior was, what your feelings were, and help me to understand what it truly means to be a human sexual person. I don't think you can learn that from books. But you have a wonderful resource right here. You know, beautiful human women who can tell you how it is for them. And that's a resource that, you know, is just dynamite. So my hope is that each of you will try to make your contribution to creating an atmosphere here at Progress Valley that's safe, an atmosphere in your recovery groups that's safe. And then, you know that old saying, what goes around comes around. When you need it for yourself, it'll be there for you. Any questions? Well, I hope you find the question box. Next time, we really will talk about some sexual facts, sexual fiction, and hopefully we'll be able to answer questions. So put your thinking caps on. That question you always wanted to ask but you were afraid to, this is the time to do it. You may stump me, but that's okay. I'll go find out and call you later. I got a lot of good research.